Blessed are those seek God with their whole heart, who also do no wrong, but walk in God's ways. You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently.
Jesus got in the boat and he went out into the lake. And this is what he said. starting in verse 3. He said, listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering his seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came, and they ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it didn't have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was too shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they just withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among the thorns, which grew up and choked out the plants, so they did not bear grain. But still, other seed fell on good soil. It came up, and it grew, and it produced a crop, multiplying 30, 60, and even 100 times. So the seeds in this story that Jesus is talking about, it's God's word. It's the Bible. And when we read the Bible, we learn more about Jesus. And the more we learn about him, the more we know about him. And the more we learn and the more we know, the closer we grow to him. And the closer we grow to him, the stronger our faith grows, right? So Jesus says that the seeds are not going to grow on a path because the birds come and eat them and take them away. We want to truly hear God's word. We want to study it. We want to know it so that our sins and our bad choices, they don't take us away from God like the birds took the seed away. Jesus said that the seeds are not going to grow in rocks because they don't have enough soil. They can't get planted deep enough to grow nice and tall, and then the sun comes out and they just wither away, don't they? We want to hear God's word. We want to plant it deep in our hearts so when trouble or hard times come, and they will, that our faith is going to be strong enough to handle anything that we're faced with. Jesus also said that the seeds are not going to grow in thorns, because the thorns, they take over and they choke out the plants, don't they? We want to hear God's word, we want it deep in our hearts, and we want to make it the most important thing in our life. We don't want to let the things of this world be more important to us than God, because those things will choke out God in our life, like the thorns choke out the plants. So when we read God's word, when we study the Bible, when we know it, we follow it, we're planting seeds in that good, rich, deep soil in our hearts. And when we do that, we grow as Christians. We grow closer to Jesus. We follow Jesus. And we are going to be moving ahead. We're going to be going in the right direction. So don't be like a boat going in circles. Don't let anything get in the way of growing closer to Jesus. Instead, move ahead. Plant God's seeds. Plant them deep in your heart. And you're going to grow closer to him. And you're going to grow in your faith. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we're thankful for this day. We're thankful for the sunshine. We are so thankful that you bless us with all that you give us. Thank you for always being with us. Dear Lord, help us to always plant your seeds deep in our hearts so that we are always growing closer to you. Thank you for the Bible. Thank you for the stories of the Bible. Thank you for teaching us. And Lord, thank you for loving us. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Service when we give back to God, but we do it silently for now.
her dedication. Master Gardener, as you have sown our lives in the rich and fertile soil, may we bear much fruit through our giving. With these offerings, may your realm be brought to earth as we plant the seeds of hope in the fields of life. Bless our gifts and our ministry, that the world may reap a harvest of generosity and love. Amen.
Do you have any joys and concerns?
We have a very big joy in our house, Samuel. Would you like to stand up? Somebody has a birthday today, and it's not just a regular birthday, he is now a teen. He's 13 today.
Donna Walker, some of you have already received your six-month statement, financial statement for the church. Some snafus, it was a new program, and I'm not the smartest cookie in the box, but I have corrected it on the computer, and hopefully everything will be fine in the next time you receive it. And also, on the 25th of July, we are hosting another mobile food pantry. It will be at the Extension Center. It will be a drive-through like it was at Trinity Lutheran Church. But we do need helpers, so they will enter on the north driveway and exit on the south driveway. So we need some directional people. So any volunteers would be appreciated. Thank you. And thanks, Carly, for playing for us today. Sharing your talents.
Up in the balcony also is another birthday boy. This last Wednesday, Rylan turned 4.
This is David Walker. I have a prayer concern for the Tom Ernst family in Quincy. He was killed in a car accident. Long-time referee in the area, well-known family. So we need prayers for the Tom Ernst family.
Thank you. Dilby, we give you thanks that you are always with us. And we give you thanks that you usually know what we need before we even ask. Dilby, we lift up our joys and celebration with one another. All these birthdays, Daniel being 13 and Carly 22 and Ryland 4. And we give you thanks for their lives. And we give you thanks for you being in their lives. We give you many, many thanks for this new year to grow and to grow closer to you, dear Lord. And we give you thanks for, and we ask for your help for leaders that will help with this hosting of this food pantry and on the 25th, that you be with us and guide us and get in and have many volunteers so that we can help others in your name. And though we have all these joys, but dear, we also have concerns. And we ask that you be with the Tom Hurst family. Lord, that you comfort them and give them peace, your peace that passes all human understanding, dear Lord, that just makes us go, how? Then we ask that you bring them comfort and let them know that they are very loved. And be with all those folks who are mourning his passing, his friends, his colleagues, his family. Be with all of them. And so we lift up Jean McAllister. She's receiving hospice, dear Lord, and we ask that you be with her and her family and bring her comfort. And so we lift up all those who are dealing with the coronavirus. It's kind of hit home. It's close to my family who lives in Mount Pulaski. We've had several outbreaks there, dear Lord, and I ask that you be with them all. And dear Lord, we know we can trust you and love you, and that you're with us always. And I give you thanks. And dear Lord, be with all of those who may not have spoke out today. Maybe they thought it was too little or too big to share with everyone. But you know what they need. And you hear the faintest cries of our hearts. And you know exactly what we need before we even ask. So we can be sure that you will answer all these prayers the way you see fit. For you see that bigger picture than we do. And though we also ask that you be with our servicemen and women and their families, we pray for their safety. We pray for the parent, the people who have to stay behind, that you give them comfort and let them see their loved ones every once in a while. We especially in this area pray for David, Amon's son, and Angie Waddell, and Dusty Waddell, Waddell, I think. But Julie, you know their names better than I do, and you know who they are. And we ask that you keep them safe and bring them home safely. And don't we give you thanks? We give you thanks that you sent your son here to die on that cross for all of our sins because you love us so much. And Jesus didn't just do that. He taught us how to be and to become closer to you. And he taught us many things, but he also taught us how to pray. He taught us these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
comes from Genesis 25, verses 19 through 34. These are the descendants of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he took to wife Rebekah, the daughter of Bethuel, the Aramean of Paddan Aram, the sister of Laban, the Aramean. And Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife, because she was barren. And the Lord granted his prayer, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. The children struggled together within her, and she said, "If it is thus, why do I live?" So she went to inquire of the Lord, and the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples born of you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other. The elder shall serve the younger." When her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. The first came forth red, all his body like a hairy mantle. So they called his name Esau. Afterward, his brother came forth, and his hand had taken hold of Esau's heel. So his name was called Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. When the boys grew up, Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, while Jacob was a quiet man dwelling in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he ate of his game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once when Jacob was boiling pottage, Esau came in from the field, and he was famished. And Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red pottage, for I am famished." Therefore his name was called Edom. Jacob said, "First, sell me your birthright." Esau said, "I am about to die. Of what use is a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me first." So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage and lentils, and he ate and drank, and rose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright.
Our gospel lesson comes from Matthew chapter 13, verses 1 through 9, and verses 18 through 23. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such crowds gathered around him that he got into the boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the bank, on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen." And then it goes on in verse 18. "Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble and persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth chokes the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, in another 30. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Almighty God, may the words on my lips and the meditations of all of our hearts be made acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Jesus told a lot of stories, and to get his point across, many of these parables or stories played on things that those original hearers understood and they were familiar with, like growing things, like seeds, or looking for lost sheep. I suspect today Jesus might have even used quizzes on the internet to illustrate a point, but maybe this story is just a little bit better. We can take all kinds of personality quizzes online that say things like, we can guess this about you by the way you answer these questions. And today, in our story today, Jesus tells four different kinds of soil. He told a story about a sower who threw seeds on different kinds of soil or ground. But later, with his disciples, he explains the parable or the story to them in ways that they can understand. See, there were four kinds of soil, and there are four responses that we can have when we hear the Word of God or we read the Word of God. So I ask you today, what kind of soil are you today? The first kind is that seed that falls on that path that quickly is eaten up by the birds. And Jesus explains that that was the person who hears that word but doesn't understand it. And the devil, the evil one, snatches it away, what was sown in the heart. See, the word of God doesn't make sense to this person. That it could be an atheist. It could be somebody who actually is here in this building and in church. It doesn't get in. They don't let it into their hearts and into their lives and live it out. I did a lot of traveling when I was going to seminary. We took the train, the Amtrak train from Lincoln to Chicago a lot, every week, in fact. And I get on that train twice a week because I go there and come back. but this one time I was in Union Station on my way home. And I met a veteran. And we were sitting there waiting for our train to be called, and he asked why I was in Chicago. And I told him I was going to school. And he said, for what? And so I began to explain that I was going to be an elder in the United Methodist Church, and that I was going to seminary. And the next thing he said was, well, I don't know how anyone can believe in God. And I said, well, I'm not sure I understand how anyone couldn't believe in God from my experience. He began to tell me about this sister who had been trying to convert him for years. And he's like, she's been trying to convert me for years with that Jesus stuff. And it's just not going to happen, is what he told me. And I began telling him stories about how I saw God working in my life and how I'd seen him work in my life over and over and over. And he kept telling me, well, those were people doing those things. I said, well, in this one particular story, I hadn't told anybody I needed anything. The only person I had said anything to was in my brain to God. So when I received an envelope in the mail with exactly the amount of money I needed, and when I received it, all it said was, Jesus loves you on the envelope, pretty much thought that was a God thing. And he said it was, and so I explained to him, I said, but the people in my story were reacting to what God put in their hearts. Because I didn't tell anyone I needed help. Nobody had no idea that I needed help. But exactly what I needed came at the exact right time. I expected him to move away to like the other side of the room, you know, because he obviously, you know, was talking to someone who believed in God very much.
And turns out, he came and sat right next to me, so he could hear me better. I was like, okay. We kept talking about God. Well, turns out we were on the same train, and it was crowded that evening. I always liked it when it wasn't crowded because you had to sit by yourself. But when I entered that train, I knew I was going to be sitting with somebody. I didn't expect to see the veteran because he got to get on the train earlier than I did. And as soon as he saw me, he began motioning to me, come sit here. I was like, oh boy. I began to pray to God at that moment to tell me what this guy needed to hear, what I needed to say to this man, because obviously he wanted to know more. And I knew that I might be planting a seed, a faith, that I may never know if it grew. I may never know if it got on fertile soil or not. It obviously didn't with the sister, but maybe, just maybe it happened on that train. I may never know. But he obviously was one of those who it got snatched away over and over. But I hope in the story that time it took. The next kind of soil is that kind that when the rocky soil, the springs up quickly but didn't have any roots, so it withers away. Jesus says this person hears that word and they receive it with great joy. But when troubles or trials come, they fall away. Well, there's a story by an author unknown. And it goes like this. One Sunday morning during a service, a 2,000-member church congregation was surprised to see two men enter. Both were covered from head to toe in black, carrying submachine guns. One of the men proclaimed, "Anyone willing to take a bullet for Christ, remain where you are." Immediately, the choir fled, the deacons fled, and most of the congregation left. Out of the 2,000, only 20 remained. The man who had spoken took off his hood, looked at the preacher, and said, "Okay, Pastor, I got rid of all the hypocrites. Now you can begin your service. Have a nice day." And the two turned and walked out. Now, I'm not up here calling anybody a hypocrite. But I've often wondered, when I've heard of ISIS and some of these other groups, Columbine many years ago, would I fall away to protect myself? Time would only tell, I guess. Or if I ever got in that situation. But Jesus said in Matthew 16:25, "For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake will find it." And with that verse, I hope that even faced with death, that I will proclaim my faith in God. For I believe there's another scripture in the Bible that Jesus said, "If you deny me before others, I will deny you before the Father," or something along that line. I don't want to be denied before the Father, so I hope I will stand my ground. But the folks who identify with this soil are often the ones who will flee. They'll flee for any kind of trial. It could be anything, like a loved one's death or illness, or something bad happens in their life that doesn't go the way they want it. There are a lot of people who say, "Well, if God was a just God and loved me, he wouldn't let this happen to me. Why did he let this happen to you?" It's okay to ask why. But if you flee and turn your back on God instead of trusting him with that why, you're like this soil. But those are hard questions to answer, because the main answer is that we live in a sinful world still, and Jesus never promised that following him was going to be easy. He did promise, though, to always, always be with us through it all. And then there's that thorny soil. Jesus says, this is the ones who hear the word and
this world and money get in the way of the word of God, being thoughtful in this person's life. I see, I know a lot of people in this category who money is so much more important to them than anything else, sometimes even more important than their family. They let money rule their lives. They often have more than one job because they need more money. And they'll spend all that time working and spend very little time with their family and their children because they're always working. So they wake up for it, they buy their children all these things, toys to try to make them happy. And it never makes them happy. Because all the kids want is their mom or their dad. But then they need more money to buy more stuff. So it's an endless, fruitless cycle. They're so busy trying to be like the world and look successful that they forget about God. God who could help them be fruitful and successful. So then there's that last soil, the one I'm pretty sure we all want to be, that fertile soil. Jesus says this is the soil where the person hears the word and they understand it and they bear fruit. They bear that fruit. I think the story that I found illustrates that how that fruit might manifest itself today. This story is called An Unspoken Bible, and the author is unknown. See, his name is Bill. If you can imagine him, he has wild hair, and he wears a t-shirt that has holes in it everywhere. And he has no shoes. And he's wearing jeans. Okay, there's probably holes in his jeans, too. This is literally the wardrobe for his entire 4 years of college. He's brilliant, he's kind of eccentric and very, very bright. And he became a Christian recently while attending college. And across from campus is this well-dressed, very conservative church. And one day, Bill decides he's going to go there for church. And as he walks in, his usual wardrobe, the jeans, the holy shirt, the wild hair, all of that, no shoes. The service had already started. And as he's starting to aisle looking for a seat, the church is so completely packed he can't find a seat. By now, everybody's looking rather uncomfortable because no one says anything, but Bill is getting closer and closer and closer to the pulpit, and he realizes there aren't any seats. So he decides to just squat down right there on the carpet. This is a perfectly acceptable behavior at the college fellowship, but it had never happened in that church before. So by now, the people are really, really uptight, and the tension in the air is thick. And about this time, the minister realizes that from way back in the back of the church, an elder is slowly making his way towards Bill. Now, this elder, he's in his 80s, he has silver gray hair, and he's got that three-piece suit on, and he's walking with a cane. Very elegant, very dignified, very portly. And he starts walking towards this boy. And everyone's saying to themselves, well, you can't blame him for what he's about to do. How can you expect that man to understand his age and of his background, understand this college kid on the floor? It takes a really long time for the man to touch the boy. And the church is utterly silent except for the clicking of this man's cane, and all eyes are focused on him. You can't hear anyone breathing. The minister has stopped preaching the sermon until the elder does whatever it is that he's about to do. Now, the elderly man drops his cane on the floor, and with great difficulty, he lowered himself and he sits down next to Bill and worships with him so he won't be alone. Everyone choked up with emotion, and the minister gains control finally, and he says, what am I about to preach? You'll never remember what you've just seen. You'll never forget. Be careful how you live. You may be the only Bible some people will ever read. As Christians, we too, when we're out in the world at our work, out in the world in stores, the gas station, wherever, we may be the only Bible some people will ever see. We may be somebody's only connection to God. So it's really important that our actions match our words, our words of faith. If we profess to be followers of Christ, we should be exhibiting the fruit that shows that fact. I believe some of those fruits should be the love and joy and peace, patience and hope, gentleness, self-control, kindness, compassion, empathy, endurance when things are hard, caring for other people. See, others should know we are Christians because we love other people. And that love can come in so many forms. Many of those I've already read. But there's a few more that I didn't. You could be showing love to someone by giving them grace and forgiveness. Like in the story called The Ticket, the author, again, is unknown. Jack took a long look at his speedometer before slowing down. 73 in a 55 zone for the fourth time in as many months. How could a guy get caught so often? When his car had slowed down to 10 miles an hour, Jack pulled over, but only partially. Let the cop worry about the potential travel hazard, he thought. Maybe some other car will tweak his backside with a mirror. The cop was stepping out of the car, a big pad in hand. Bob? It's Bob from church? Jack sunk farther in his seat into his trench coat. This was worse than the coming ticket. A Christian cop catching a guy from his own church? A guy who happened to be a little anxious to get home after a long day at the office? A guy he was about to play golf with tomorrow? Jumping out of the car, he approached the man he saw every Sunday, a man he'd never seen in uniform before. Hi, Bob. Fancy meeting you like this. Hello, Jack. No smile. Guess you caught me red-handed, Fred. In a rush to see my wife and kids. Yeah, I guess so. Bob didn't seem, seemed a little uncertain about that. Jack says, good. I've seen some long days at the office lately. I'm afraid I bent the rules just a bit this once. Jack toed at the pebble on the pavement. Diane said something about roast beef and potatoes tonight. Know what I mean? I know what you mean, but I also know, Bob said, that you have a reputation in our precinct. Sorry. Ouch. This was not going in the right direction. Time to change tactics. What did you clock me at, 71? Bob said, 71. Would you sit back in your car, please? Now, wait a minute here, Bob, Jack said. I checked as soon as I saw you. I was barely nudging 65. The lies seemed to come easier with every ticket. Please, Jack, Bob said, in the car. Flustered, Jack hunched himself through the steel open door, slamming it shut, and stared at the dashboard. He was in no rush to open that window. The minutes ticked by. Bob scribbled on the pad. Why hadn't he asked for my driver's license? But whatever the reason, it's going to be a month of Sundays before Jack ever sat near that cop again. Tapped on the door, jerked his head to the left. There was Bob with a folded paper in hand. Jack rolled down the window just a few inches, just enough for Bob to pass him the slip of paper. Thanks. Jack couldn't even keep the sneer out of his voice, and Bob returned to his car without a word. Jack watched his retreat in the mirror, and he unfolded the sheet of paper. How much was this one going to cost, he thought. Wait a minute, what's this?
Some kind of joke? Certainly not a ticket. And Jack began to weep. Dear Jack, once upon a time, I had a daughter. She was 6 when she was killed by a car, by a speeding driver. A fine and 3 months of jail, and the man was free. Free to hug his daughters, all 3 of them. I only had one. And I'm gonna have to wait till heaven before I ever get to hug her again. 1,000 times I've tried to forgive that man, and 1,000 times I thought I had. Maybe I did. But I need to do it again, even now. Pray for me, and be careful. My son is all I have left, Bob. Jack twisted around in time to see Bob's car pull away and headed down the road. Jack watched it disappear, and a full 15 minutes later, he too pulled away and drove slowly home, praying for forgiveness, and hugged his surprised wife and children when he had arrived home. Life is precious. Handle with care. Bob showed Jack some mercy. He showed him some forgiveness. And maybe it planted a seed in fertile ground. See, although they went to the same church in the beginning of the story, Jack was not loving his neighbor. He was putting other people at risk for his own agenda. See, true agape, or unconditional love for others, puts others first, yourself next, or last. Bob, he showed that unconditional love for Jack. He gave Jack mercy and forgiveness and a second chance. See, God does that for us. So no matter what soil you are today, if you ask God for help, God will help you be fruitful soil that can lead others to Christ. God will help you love other people. We just have to open our hearts to Christ. So let us pray that we can be fruitful, fertile soil for Christ, sowing seeds of love to all we meet wherever we go, as we go about our week this week. Amen. Our closing hymn is Wonderful Word of Life.
Go.